ask Dr. Callahan, please?
We did, yes.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to thank our chairman and committee for having me. I have some money here. My name is Richard Callahan. I got my PhD at UMass Amherst in entomology in 1970. I've done work with pesticides, and especially looking at the subacute and sublethal effects of pesticides on animals. I've been associated with that for about 50 years. I started pharmaceutical companies that went public, which are based on bioassay data. I've done and run some of the biggest marine programs I've done in the country, looking at the effects of pollution on all kinds of marine organisms. And I've worked with many, many universities, and also started a lot of different companies, several companies. I gave you some details on it, probably went through all of them. I want to, first of all, just mention a couple of things that maybe committees are aware of, of what neonicotinoid pesticides are. They're derivatives of nicotine. And nicotine is, of course, made by tobacco plants. And tobacco plants make nicotine for a purpose. They make nicotine to kill insects. There are very few insects that eat tobacco. And nicotine also, of course, is known to give you a little head buzz. That's why people smoke it for many years. Neonicotinoid pesticides are synthetic derivatives of nicotine. And what our chemists did was they did two things. One, they made it more toxic to insects, but they also made it less toxic to mammals by taking advantage of a very small difference between some protein receptors in the mammalian nervous system and that in insects and other arthropods. So as a result, these materials are much less toxic to us in an acute level, which means in a deadly level, immediate level, than they are to insects. As a result, the tolerances for these materials in food are much, much higher than they are for other classes of insecticides, like organic phosphates, carbamates, and those kind of materials. They work on exactly the same mechanisms in our nervous systems as are in insects. They inhibit cholinesterase, and we have exactly the same chemicals in our system that insects do. The nervous system in animals is the most conserved system in evolution. It's the last thing to change. And the reason it's the last thing to change is that when you mess it up through like a random mutation, you don't survive. So it's very, very conserved. So many of the very same mechanisms that drive and develop the nervous system in humans are the very, very same systems that drive and develop them in very primitive animals that we're separated from by millions of years. Now, that's an important thing to understand when you're looking at neonicotinoids. Evidence has been accumulated for about half a dozen years that neonicotinoid insecticides are severely damaging the environment. The USGS recently published data showing that the Mississippi rivers and the Missouri river systems and all of the tributaries are just contaminated with neonics at very, very high levels. Researchers in England, Europe, and the U.S. have published dozens. I was thinking of putting together actually a bibliography, just giving it to you, but it looked like a phone book of all the studies that are showing, especially in Europe, the really devastating effects, but there's subtle effects. It's kind of like a sign of spring kind of effects. When DDT was slowly knocking off raptorial birds because they made thin eggshells, people didn't see it. Things just melted away. That's what's happening. Recent publications, just to name a few places, a few things. There's a publication that came out in Nature, which is, by the way, the premier scientific journal in the world. So very often people that do this work are kind of written off by industry, and my colleagues and I have been treated to this kind of treatment as kind of kooky folks. But this is a Nature publication where the Swedish show that when you give bumblebees very small amounts of these materials, they just don't reproduce well. Another study at Oxford University, also published in Nature, this was in the last just couple of weeks, showed that when you feed very good honeybees a choice, I'm sorry, again, bumblebees, a choice between syrup that has very, very low levels of neonicotinoids in it, or nothing in it, no pesticide, they prefer the neonicotinoid, which has some implications when you think of what's happening in the field. As a result of prior research, including ours, the European Union placed a moratorium on neonic use for 2 years, and I'm quoting here, based on the body of evidence, we see that it's absolutely correct to take a precautionary approach to ban these chemicals, that was by Jack McGlade, who's the European Union Executive Director for the Environmental. The province of Ontario, Canada, has strictly regulated their cosmetic uses of many pesticides, which is something that should be really looked at. By cosmetic uses, we're talking about you just, you know, fill the stuff in your lawn, you treat the flowers in your garden. Before you see insects, you just put the stuff down. That's typically what happens. You have a lawn care company come to your yard, they're treating them with these things. Because just in case. So there's thousands of tons of this material that's being used every year for no real reason. We deserve testimony saying that what you do is you treat the seeds and then you plant the seeds and the plant is treated. You haven't had any pesticides yet. You haven't had any pests. But you treat them anyway. So as a result, this material is getting in the groundwater, they're everywhere. They're in everything you eat. They're in everything you're getting at the end of your drink. The state of New York, Ontario has just passed legislation in the last couple of weeks that is going to severely limit the use of neonicotinoids. One of the downsides of this material has been, and this whole class of materials, is that it has changed the way farmers actually manage their crops. There used to be a system where you go out and evaluate the health of your crops and decide when you needed to spray. That was because spraying was costly, materials cost a lot of money, and so you would use what's called integrated pest management. And you would decide, getting a certain amount of aphids on this crop, it's time for me to spray before I start getting real damage. They don't do that anymore for many, many of these crops. You just treat it. It becomes treated. You buy an apple tree, a little sapling in a pot at Home Depot, it's probably already been treated. Because there won't be a mark on those leaves. Everything that eats it dies. So Alex Liu, who's going to speak in a few minutes, and I can't walk on myself, but they're feeding colonies of bees cumulative doses of neonicotinoids for the last 4 years. And we've been treating them with about 3 milligrams of neonicotinoids for the whole season. That's a cumulative dose. 3 milligrams is about 1/9500 of an ounce, which is not much material. So over the whole summer, we put that much into a hive. We measured the effects on the hives very carefully. We published 2 papers on this, peer-reviewed papers, and we have some other data that's in your package that I'm going to talk about in a minute. What we find is that the hives do fine all summer. In fact, they can't tell the difference between the treated and untreated hives. When the winter comes, all the bees between December and March, all the bees that are in the treated hive just get up and leave. It's CCD. It's exactly that. We have induced colony collapse disorder in these hives multiple times, and simply by treating small amounts of the hives. There are people that criticize our work based on saying we're using higher doses than occur in nature. I don't know if you're familiar with the term red herring. Red herring is used in a when you're buying and selling company somewhere, but when you throw out an issue like a red fish and a big school of fish to draw the attention away from what a real school is here. What we're doing is we're feeding this pesticide in high fructose corn syrup, which is 27% water. Right? Nectar is roughly, it varies a lot, but it'd be 90% water. So it's a threefold dilution to get to nectar. The bees are bringing in nectar from other sources that aren't contaminated. You're diluting more. So our dosage is a 3 milligram per hive of the Salmeter doses is a very low number and very realistic for that environmental. Once we're doing that, I'm going to the paper I'm going to show you. We got thinking about what is it that's making these bees suddenly leave? It's a behavioral change in the way the bees behave. And so it occurred to us that it may be something that's going on when they're in the larval stage or when bees pupate. You think of a caterpillar. Insects really have two embryological periods. You have the egg makes a caterpillar. Think of that. But then the caterpillar goes and pupates and changes its whole body structure. It turns most of its genes off and turns on another whole bunch of genes and builds a different animal. So out comes a butterfly. Not like a caterpillar. But our thinking was, well, in that process, these animals have got some of the pesticide in there, and maybe that's what's causing the problem. So we designed an experiment where we took, we did this with 12 hives, but I'll just give you an example. If you look side by side, you treat one hive with the pesticide all summer. At the end of the summer, we dump all the bees from all these hives and weigh them. Take them all out of the hives, put them in a box, weigh them. Now we know how many bees are in each hive. And we took the bees from that were treated as larvae, you know, all summer, and we put them in the hive that had never been treated. So all the honey in that hive is clean. Then we took the bees that hadn't been treated at all, and they're all adults now. We did this when they stopped raising their young at the end of the year. We took just the adults and put them in the treated hive. Now all the honey in that hive is contaminated. And then we left them, and then we had to switch the location of the hive so the bees don't think they've been moved. And we take a look at what happened. And if you look at the presentation of the little paper I gave you here, you'll see bar graphs showing the number of bees in the hives before we treated them. They're all basically the same, 14 to 19,000 bees. But take a look at the red bars, which are the bees treated only as adults. All right. We're missing thousands, you know, 9,000, 10,000 bees have just left the hive. The hives are empty, basically, in this world. The control hives have a big mat of dead bees on the bottom of the hive, which is the typical thing that everybody, representatives, can testify to. When you open your hive in the spring, there are a lot of dead bees at the bottom because they can't leave the hive during the winter. It's too cold. So they die in the hive, you clean them out. These bees that have been neonicotinoid pesticides, which is certain death. Now, what's the significance of this? Well, to bees, it's significant in areas that use lots of neonics, but it's actually a lot more significant than that, because this isn't just bee behavior you're talking about. Anything that affects bee behavior, because of the way the neural system is conserved, is going to affect all insects, absolutely certain. It probably affects all arthropods. It may affect all annelids and a whole lot of other animals. How far up the phylogenetic tree you go, I don't know, we haven't run the test. But you can be damn sure of every insect. So if you look at what's happening in insects, modern butterflies have been, crashing. All kinds of insect species are going down. The insectivorous birds, swallows, vireos, warblers, all these animals are in decline. And if you're kind of skeptical, wondering, if this is true or not, I'll suggest you do your own experiment. When you're driving home tonight, take a look at your windshield. And just remember what it used to be like 20, 30 years ago. When you drive down the highway, you'd be putting your wipers on and scrubbing your windshield. You're not doing it anymore. Right? You just don't need to do it. It's something that needs to be controlled. So getting to the business of the legislature, it turned out that honeybees are really a powerful indicator species, kind of a canary in the coal mine, as well as very important pollinators. Keeping bee populations plentiful is increasingly difficult due to the combined assault of agricultural poisons and foreign parasites affected bacterial and viral diseases. There's no question varroa mite's a problem. Controlling neonics is not going to solve that problem. But varroa mite only affects honeybees. There's a lot of other animals out there. Massachusetts is fortunate that a very effective bee inspection program has been mandated for many years. Although Although the program has a history of very spotty administration, some counties have had terrible inspection programs. Others have, like, very frankly, Worcester County, like, a terrific inspection program. And we have almost no disease, almost, I mean, very little vermin and fowl in that county. Don't have to treat for it. It's, you can have clean honey without antibiotics. All commercial beekeeping is treated with antibiotics because they all have fowl in American fowl. They're part of the business. Hobbyists don't. It's one of the big differences between hobbyists and commercial beekeeping. We don't treat with, almost nobody treats with antibiotics because we don't need to. You get rid of that inspection program, you're going to need to. It's very important to understand that many of the commercial beekeepers are bringing in nucleus hives and packet bees are given to business, bring them in. Well, what comes in with them is disease, all right? And who inspects them? Obviously, you'd be inspectors. That's why they're inspected. That's why we want them. That's why we want, there aren't too many people that are in business that are going to come, especially a businessman like me. So I come into you and say, I want government inspectors. It's a rare thing, but we want bee inspectors. And we want the inspectors that help us with the hives and are allowed to actually look at us and work with us and work with the beginning beekeepers and help us identify viruses. There's dozens of diseases. A good inspector identifies almost everyone from by sight. It's a skill. It's a high skill. And you need people to do that. Many of the people that are talking about changing these laws are really looking at changing that program. At least we believe that. And we have reasons to believe it. Any investigation, so I'm recommending, frankly, that House Bill 731 just be dropped. I think the best thing to do is just modify and strengthen the inspection program, continue the funding, and make sure we have good educated inspectors in every town. And I'd be all for that. I think changing the management practices so that there are professional mentors, which has been suggested, paid for, who knows how, that the people that are bringing in nucleus hives and package hives are in charge of the inspections or help tell you when you need an inspector. I was born at night, but not last night. I think I know how this works. Any meaningful inspection into the causes of a disease such as colony collapse disorder requires the expertise, people trained in toxicology, bacteriology, virology, ecology, and other sciences to bring real insight into the possible mechanisms of the result of the disorder. H3417 does not accomplish this. Instead, it assembles a group of farmers, beekeepers, legislators, nurserymen, landscapers, and one academic person to quote study CCD. I'm sure these are all intelligent people, but they aren't qualified. That's a committee that can't come up with any meaningful information. I recommend you don't pass that. In contrast, I think House 655 takes a bold, if a small step, in addressing the pollinator problem. It limits the current indiscriminate use, and it is indiscriminate use, of neonicotinoids to licensed operators and requires them to inform customers of the environmental hazards of the materials that will be placed on their properties. Currently, landscapers prophylactically treat lawns, gardens, trees to minimize upkeep. We just had testimonies that farmers that raise vegetables do exactly the same thing. Plant the seed, plant the seed with the pesticide. Just do it prophylactically, just in case. It's equivalent to taking a prescription medication in the absence of any symptoms, just in case. It's not what your physician would suggest. H655 further requires consumers to be informed if plants, trees, and vegetables they are buying and planting on their property, often for the own consumption, have been previously treated with neonicotinoids. Such sensible regulation is not only warranted given the overwhelming accumulation of evidence of the grievous damage being incurred by these compounds, but are required by common sense. The bill is also an opportunity to show leadership at a national level and get in front of an international issue. Evidence demonstrating the devastating ecological impact of neonics is going to continue to accumulate, because the data say it's going to continue to accumulate ultimately result in harsh restriction or total ban on dealing. Despite industry denials, the data is in. The combination of systemic absorption on all parts of the plant, long persistence in soils, very high water solubility, ensuring the movement in the groundwater, and the alteration of at least insect behavior, probably other arthropods, at very low levels, is inconsistent with the massive current use. In 2010, 20,000 metric tons of active ingredient of just one, which was used in the country. Now, typically, pesticides, a formulation you would get would have 5 or 6%. Next time you buy pesticides, look at how much of it is really active ingredient. We're talking 20,000 metric tons of active ingredient was used in the United States of one human. This stuff is everywhere. It's incredible. So this is, the researchers are going to continue to document the extensive environmental damage that's being done. And they'll finally take a lot of sophistication. The mechanisms this is happening on is causing this. What's really causing this behavior problem in bees? When you think of the way the bee brain works, it's a little tiny thing, right? But they've had stacks of very sophisticated behaviors. They dance, they tell each other where the honey is, they do all kinds of things. Right? But they don't. At least we don't think that they sit there thinking, I think I'll do this now. What happens is something triggers a certain kind of behavior, and they go out and do it. What exactly, how that works, nobody knows. But it's not just a matter of these receptors that are on a synapse that we know are a little different in them that is causing this. It gives us protection in the acute level. We don't know what's going on. So we've got now a class of pesticides that we're using in an enormous quantity. And we really don't understand a lot of the mechanisms that is changing behaviors and how it works. We think we know how it works because we understand how it kills. We don't understand how it alters behavior at all. And we don't know how sensitive that is. So using it at the levels we're using it at, using it with really no restrictions at all, it doesn't make sense. So I recommend that you approve it 655. I think it's a moderate and sensible first step.
Just a couple of questions. So you mentioned that the use of premixes is huge right now and continues to grow, correct?
Yes, sir.
That the use of neomix has increased dramatically in the past few years.
Not so much in Europe, because they are regulating more and more. I've talked to people in Europe who go down the Autobahn in their Porsches at 100 miles an hour. And they have different restrictions in different parts of Europe, and most of Europe is a small place relative to us. As they go into areas with different restrictions, suddenly they're really restricted. Suddenly their windshields are a mess. They're going 100 miles an hour, in 5 minutes you're in another district. Oh, no problems. It's dramatic.
I think you mentioned in Ontario,
they have a very strict program in one province for corn and soybeans, the rich corn and soybean producers. They are banning the use of neonics unless you, one, take courses on its use, two, can demonstrate the materials that you're going to use it, that for at least 2 years you've been using integrated pest management in that field, so that then you have to go and prove that you've got an insect problem that you can't control any other way, and you have to get it confirmed by a third party. Then you can use it. They're looking to reduce the use by 80%.
You mentioned we heard from other testimony from the commission, from Guatemala, about other factors.
For high collapses
in
rehab.
How do you rate those
other? No one has ever shown any other mechanism for chronic collapses. No one has, I can assure you this, varroa mite's not possible because everybody's had hives that died from varroa mite and they don't look like chronic collapses. The only studies I know that have actually instigated colony collapse disorder in our house. And we do it by feeding the units. Now, can I tell neonics are the only thing that Collins County classes are, you know, because I haven't tested every other thing. But I have tested neonics, and tested two of them, and I go through.
And how long did you, that study go on for, I'm sorry?
Well, we're in our fourth year. Every study was a 1 year study. We start the study using, we start treating them in the first of June, and we end up ending the experiment when we open the hives in the spring. And then we build up another, we get rid of all the stuff in there, and all the contaminated materials in the hive, we start over again, and we do it again. We're in our fourth cycle.
And I think I had read somewhere, when you mentioned, because there are other reports that contradict some of those things and question some of the practices that you have. And I think one of the things that I had read was that the exposure that you did in your experiment was much longer than what would be used in the typical agricultural exposure. Is that, how would you respond to that?
That's a good point. We treat from the 1st of June until, and several of these experiments, from the 1st of June until the end of October, which is pretty much the growing season for a lot of crops, something squashing. We have not done studies to show how short you have to treat. However, I think the one I just showed you, those bees that were treated as adults only got treated when they were adults. They were never treated by, but they weren't treated all summer. So they only had exposure during the winter period. They weren't even going out. They were just eating the material in the hives, which was contaminated. So I can't answer the question of how short we could make this. We could do a whole series of experiments try to shorten it down and see what the minimum is. We also haven't done the no effect level. We've never gone low enough that we've not seen the results, which would be a classic experiment to do. Those take lots and lots of hives. It takes a lot of money. It's a big experiment. You simply give maybe 7 or 8 different treatments. You need 5 or 6 reps per treatment. We're talking, and you need a lot of controls, and it takes a lot of just beyond our means to do that.
And I think it came out in testimony before too, talking about what the general health of the hive was when these experiments started. Did you start with healthy hives?
Oh, yeah, we start these hives with packages. The hives are absolutely clean on absolutely new on comb. Every time we buy new comb, new frames, every year we start over. And we get packaged bees from big suppliers in the south. Treat them exactly like every other beekeeper here treats them, except that we feed them. You always feed packages syrup to get them started. We just keep feeding them syrup all summer so that they're getting smaller. So we get this neonicotinoid into the hives at a very low rate continuously. So the criticisms that we're using doses that are too high, as I mentioned before, they're very different. The EPA did a study to show you how this thing really is fabulous in a lot of ways. A series of EPA people were involved in a large study that they could not publish on peer review journal. They published it on what's called Plus Farms on the internet. No one published it. They did is they ran a long study. They fed this, what they said was they were feeding it in pollen patties. They actually fed it in dough that they put syrup in like we did. Their low dose was 3.5 times our high dose, all right, the dose that we used. They ended up doing a sophisticated analysis, statistical analysis on the results. The results came out, if you read the paper, they report this, less than 1 chance in 100 that the dosage with neonics didn't cause higher deaths in their hives. Less than 1 chance in 100. However, they said it wasn't due to the neonic, it was due to queen problems. I mean, how do you design a study, run it for a year, you get a result very similar to what we're getting, and then decide that we didn't really, no one published the data. So the EPA is in terrific denial over this, and so is the USDA. I would like to say that just bring up, one of the reasons that the EPA was developed after silent spring, there was a realization that the United States Department of Agriculture is in the business and has done a terrific job, if you look at it historically, in helping farmers. Those aren't his stakeholders. It's farmers, right? People that use these materials to make a living, and they have given us all a lot of food, it's cheap, it's great, but they have a basic conflict of interest when it comes to talking about pesticides and protecting the environment, but they're interested in, like any other business person, in their product, which is food. So I'd have to point out, having, you know, professional agricultural organizations and even frankly the commissioner, picking who's a wonderful guy, you're asking him to kind of cross his stakeholders when he's picking people to be on a commission that's going to talk about managing bees that really are somewhat in conflict with pesticides. People that raise bees are just part of the world. That's the way it is. It's not that one set's a bunch of good folks and the other set's a bunch of bad folks. It's just a natural tension that's there. And to have one group picking how that's going to be run and how you're going to reorganize how you manage the other group, that's really pretty naive.
Have you been involved with the pollinator stewardship that Bonanno spoke about for the Mass Farm Bureau?
No, I was, and I was, it's interesting, I'm a director of the Worcester County Beekeepers. We never heard about this. I talk to people at all the other groups. We have, I don't know of any other county groups that really would do it. Individuals that knew, there must have been some kind of a secrecy thing because we never heard. And I'll be very frankly, I've sat on a lot of boards of directors. I've been a director since I was about 35, one or two different organizations, a lot of them private, for-profits, a lot of non-profits, I've run non-profits. I don't know how you sit on a board of directorship and start talking to other people about the business of that group that you're a director of and not tell the rest of the directors. I mean, just do what you do. And that's what happened on that thing pretty widely across the state. It's a lot of the reason why the emotional heat that you're feeling back is as high as it is. And like I said, I was born in 1999 last night.
I appreciate that. Yes.